On behalf of Inclusion Press, I want to welcome you all to today's workshop, and we are very grateful to you, Heather Simmons from Scotland, for being so generous as to offer this session today. Heather is a beloved friend and colleague who on November 12th joined three other people in helping us launch Ideas That Matter as part of the Virtual Summer Institute. And you gave a short talk and had a breakout session, Heather, and we are very grateful for that and invited you to offer a workshop. And you have embodied the best of what the Summer Institute is about in really taking a stretch and thinking about what matters most to you and sharing that. And the ideas have continued to unfold for what you want to share with us today. And the session is The Gentle Art of Noticing. And you are a gifted storyteller. I could listen to you actually read the phone book. And we're really excited to hear the reflections you have and what you've been thinking about on your journey. I know some of these ideas have been percolating for years, and the support team with you today includes Dave Hasbury and Patty Scott and myself and Kathy Hollins, who you will not see visibly, but she's been, as many folks would know, behind the scenes. And Jack Pierpoint would have been here today, but was really called away on personal emergency of a friend, and his thoughts, you know, are with all of us and with you, Heather. So this is a stretch for everyone, and we're grateful for it. And I want to turn it over to you, Heather, and we'll all do our best to just lean in and be with you.
Well, thanks, Linda. Thanks for the introduction. I suppose it could still happen. This workshop might have been done under the Trades Description Act, because it's changed so much from what I'd originally thought I was offering, which was to talk about the experience of an organisation that I worked for, their experiences we travelled through COVID, but it's kind of morphed into something else. And I want to say from the get-go that this is just the world according to me, okay? This is the busy world of Heather Simmons, which may resonate with you, it may not. I hope it does, and I hope that it really is an offering today, there's no promise of anything, but maybe just the opportunity to think about something and think about them a bit differently. I want to kick off our thinking or kickstart our thinking by reading from this man whose name is Michael Lunig. And some of you will have heard me speak about him before. Kirk, I know, is a big fan, so he's absolutely delighted. Lunig has this character called Mr. Curly and his friend Vasco Pajama, okay? And Vasco goes out on a journey across the world and sees what he can see. And so I want to, and they exchange letters between them. And so I want to plant the seed of this letter and see what it takes us in the workshop, okay? This is Mr. Curly writing to Vasco Pajama. Dear Vasco, the rose plants have just this day been made available at the Curly Flat Rose Farm. As usual, a small ensemble from the Academy of Ancient Music performed a selection of old airs and dances in celebration. I purchased two roses for my collection, Baby's Bottom and Grandmother's Kiss. Like all roses from the farm, the origins of these two plants are unknown. They are old mystery roses, and of course, the ensemble only played old music of unknown authorship, probably composed by birds in the dawn of history. Baby's Bottom, as you might imagine, has a plump, rounded flower with pink petals of the most delicate texture and colour. The perfume is delightfully reminiscent of a baby's breath. Grandmother's Kiss has a large, blousy, crinkled flower, with an abundance of big loose petals of deep crimson. It has a distinct handbag fragrance. which comes in great volumes and alters markedly as the day progresses. The evening aroma is quite different to the aroma of the morning. How arresting is the credential unknown origin? How deep and rich it seems, how vibrant and free and magical, like a talisman, seems that creature, that plant, or that thing of unknown origin. And I'll just finish the letter there. The thing that I want you to take away from that is this notion about unknown origin. I come from this strong belief that we support hundreds of people, thousands of people. We help them to live their lives, and yet we hardly know them. We know them in a very functional way, and I'll talk about that in a minute or two, but we hardly know who they are. We have some cracks at it. We do some person-centered planning, and we try to ask them some interesting questions, but and one of the things that I've been realizing, I suppose, after a 30-odd year career in this field is that I'm as guilty as anyone else of not really knowing people. And I've tried to find another way of seeing people and a way of understanding them and a way of connecting with them. And I think that's what I want to talk about today. I want to talk about what we notice and talk about how we can help people to be known, their whole selves to be known. So as I say, we'll see where we end up, right? As it's an offering, let's take it from there. I thought it would be good for you to have the opportunity to speak to one another for just a few minutes. I'm really interested in you. We're going to go into breakout rooms. I think there'll be three people in each room, and all the way through the workshop. Okay. What I'm interested in is that you welcome one another and you just get your names and so on. But I am really interested in what drew you to the workshop today. And think about that. What made you sign on? And even when you got the alternative description of what was happening, what kept you coming to the workshop today? So just a few minutes to think about that. Five minutes max. In fact, let's make it 4 minutes. Let's just be really awkward. 4 minutes and then we'll be back. So you've got to speak fast. You've got to get your ideas together, right? You've got a minute each. Ready, steady, breakout rooms, please. The magic of Zoom. I always think there should be a drum roll or something here.
Functionally, you don't need to do anything. You will be transported to the breakout room. You can click join. You will be transported when it's over. There's one group that's got four folks just for now.
Okay. Right. Go for it. Have fun. I find this just completely amazing. It's time traveling. It's just incredible. So great. You're all back in one piece. No one's got the bends or anything, sort of terrible due to being in another galaxy far, far away. So that's great stuff. Can I just ask a couple of people just to kind of randomly say something about what was drawing them to the workshop? We have loads of time to hear everyone, but tell me what made you stick around for this even after you got the notice saying it's going to be different.
Anyway. I think that in our group people seem to agree that it was about the community that we expected to find here.
Okay.
And then there was also some comments about your storytelling, Heather. But.
Right. Okay. Well, that's great. It is a smashing community. It's so nice to see people popping up again and recognizing them. There's Catherine and there was someone else in my group. Sylvia, I keep seeing various things. So it's good. Any other comments? Any other reasons that people have come along? What's drawing?
I would just echo Laurie's comments and also say you have just a lovely, sweet voice that I just like listening to. And what you were saying too about transporting, it does feel like, a stepping away. It feels like it's traveling, being in these virtual sessions.
Yeah. That's good. I want you to know that a Scottish accent is my secret weapon. Okay. I got one of the best pieces of advice ever, but it's also been like a curse in my ear. When I was a student at college, I was a particularly lazy student and we had tons of group work to do. We would be given a question on a Monday, then we'd have to go off and research it in our groups and then come back and present on the Friday. And I just used to wing it a lot. I'd read a few things and then I'd be able to stand up and talk. Until one day a tutor said to me, can I speak to you? I said, oh yeah. Huh? She said, you know, you're a really good communicator. Just make sure you've got something to say. And I just was like, oh my gosh, I've just been completely rumbled by that. And I have to say, I'm feeling a wee bit like this today because this is new material, a new way. You know, I'm thinking, oh, is there something to say here? So let's keep your fingers crossed and see whether or not there is. Dave, could I ask you to put your screen up, please, so that we could crack on? Okay, so here we are. The gentle art of noticing. I loved this quote from Pam Houston. I'm about going into the world and noticing stuff and going home and writing it down and putting it next to other stuff I've noticed and seeing what happens. And this workshop today has been a wee bit like that, except it's not that I saw something while I was out and about and wrote it down. I read something in 1999 and then it's resonated with something that's happening today, some of my experiences today. And I'm kind of putting that together and thinking, is there something that's bigger that's waiting to become? So it's about noticing. There's nothing, I'm not going to ask you to do anything that's any more difficult than that, than just simply to notice what's going on around you and around the people whose lives you're sharing. Can we have the next slide, Dave? Thanks. I'd said to you initially that I was going to be talking about Sea Change and their report that highlighted our time with COVID and how the organisation had emerged through that. The inspiration for that was from a thing called the Relationship Project, and this was something that they had written, and they were observing what they or recounting what they'd seen during the time of COVID. They said, amidst the sadness and pain of recent weeks, we've also had our best days, the moments when we've noticed one another as we have seldom noticed before. And I think that's a really pretty amazing statement to make, or at least a quite profound statement to make. I think that we spend a lot of time with one another and hardly see what's going on in front of our noses. But there's something about a crisis that sharpens your senses, you know. Mm-hmm. As the air smells clearer, you know, your vision is enhanced, you're there and you're noticing things as you've seldom noticed it before. And I think it's probably one of the things to be thankful for in the midst of all of this COVID-19. We've had to look out for one another, we've had to notice where people were, what they were doing. But one of the things that I think has been the trick for me is that I got really tired of noticing people in a really functional way. I think every single person who's on this call will be really good at that. We'll be able to account for people. We would be able to give a report on how they were doing and how they were walking and whether they were losing weight or putting weight on, or whether they'd been sociable or whether they'd not, whether they'd, you know, I hate to say the word complied, but whether their behaviour had been good, or we can talk about people in all that sort of, all those sorts of ways. But when we start talking about people like human beings, we get really stuck. We get really stuck around that. And I came across a quote that John O'Brien had written in a paper from, this is the paper from 1999, called, I think it's called Great Questions and the Art of Portraiture. And he says this, he says, the service world that surrounds people with developmental disabilities seems less comfortable with the image of understanding people as an art than with the image of an objective science of assessment and intervention. Such an image of science appeals in part because it promises the sort of steady improvement in the prediction and control of people's behaviour that makes service systems more manageable. From this point of view, one gets to know a person in order to discipline need. Talk of art, imagination, and great questions can sound like the trumpets of anarchy. I started noticing people as I had seldom noticed them before. And for me, that was kind of revolutionary. And it helped me rediscover people that I worked for in a way that was quite extraordinary to me. And it helped me see people, and it helped me to think about how to write about people in a way that raised them up and put the spotlight on these, you know, incredibly human qualities that they had, the artful qualities that they had, you know, just the skill and the imagination of it all that we seem to have lost when we were thinking about folks. And, you know, I'm a Dour Scot, at least that's what they say about us, that we're Dour Scots. And I'm not really into, I don't suppose I'm sort of too fanciful about some things, but I was definitely feeling like there needed to be, you know, more whimsy, more just more artfulness connected to people, more beautiful words, more poetic images that supported people and their lives. And I've been trying to think about how to do that, use words to raise people up and tell stories that raise people up. Can I have the next slide, please? Maybe, move it on to the next one, please. Sorry, because I've just said. Now, here's the thing. This is another piece of ancient learning. When I learned to do person-centered planning, I so remember Marcia Forrest telling us that these were some of the rules. Okay, there was no digging. That's not what we're doing. We're not fixing anything. We're not judging anything, you know. We're not therapists. We're not digging around in people's psyche. And then we're not moaning about the stories. There's no complaining. There's no, that's the closest I can get to kvetching. That's how she explained it to us. You know, no nyip, nyip, nyip about the story. Remember that. That's the rules when you're listening to what people are saying. Get rid of the digging and the therapy and the wondering why. Don't try and fix it. Don't judge it. Don't moan about it. Just notice. Notice and wonder, maybe, you know. But keep it to yourself. Might take a few notes to yourself. Now you've got 5 minutes each, unless you're in this group of four. If you don't use the full 5 minutes to tell your story, just hold the space. Just hold the space so that there's an opportunity for people to think about what they're noticing. Think about what you're noticing in the words. Think about what you're noticing in the storyteller as they talk about what's going on. But here's 15 minutes for you to hear some stories, and then we'll come back and we'll see what we're going to do with them. I hope this is making sense so far. So if you could put the next slide up, Dave, that's the instructions again. And I think the instructions will be in the chat, yeah? So you'll be able to see them for each group. Is that clear? Is everyone clear about what they're doing? So we're going to do that hyperspace magic thing, okay? And we'll say, you know, abracadabra or something, and off you go, and see you in 15 minutes. Okay, is that everyone back? Great, that's great. Okay, I don't want to ask you about that experience and your stories, because we have a wee treat up our sleeves for you I think maybe two breakout rooms from now, because I'm going to ask you to write the story, really, you know, based on what you've been noticing and what else we have to say now. So just to give you a heads up about that. Now, probably you won't hear another thing I'm saying because you're all going, oh no, I have to write. So chill, okay, it won't be marked. It's just to give you a bit of practice in thinking about it. And I know that there are some of you sitting in this group who are writers. So, you know, don't be giving me your nonsense about how you'll not be able to do this. I want to talk about, you know, one of my noticings that came together, and if I can just get the cat to get off it, then, yeah. I want to show you a book called Respect, an Exploration. Are any of you familiar with it? Just put your hand up, no? Okay, this was a little John O'Brien gem from 1999. And this book has planted a seed in my brain that's just been there, you know, forever. I heard him talking about this, and first thing was, I loved the cover. I thought it was an absolutely beautiful cover. And I was, oh, sorry, yeah, can you see it? Okay. I can bring it closer. Okay. Written by a woman called Sarah Lawrence Lightfoot, who's a professor of education at Harvard, I think. She's an African-American woman. So the subject of respect is something that has vexed her often, and she's decided that she was going to try and figure out what was going on, what was respect, what did it look like, if it put a hat and coat on and showed up, how would we see it? And she interviewed six prominent African American leaders in their field, a wide ranging group of people, from a midwife to a priest who works in an AIDS hospice, to a professor of law at Harvard, to a photographer working in Harlem, did a huge project in Harlem, to a pediatrician working in a really difficult area, and a primary school teacher, I think. And she writes about each of them and talks about, she goes to see them work and she talks about what she sees, what she notices. She identifies six components. And Dave, I wonder if you could share the screen, would you? Thanks. Excuse me, you'll not believe this, but my cat is now, of course, sitting in the place that he shouldn't really sit in, and he's chewing my notes. Get off. Sorry, we just have a bit of domestic housekeeping here. What a bism. Right. So anyway, so she identifies these six components of respect, empowerment, healing. She talks about the dialogue that exists between people, the sort of back and forward exchange of knowledge and interest. She talks about curiosity as being an essential component of respect, a strong sense of self-respect, and the ability to pay attention being given to a situation. These are all elements that she identifies in the work of the people that she interviews. Now, Lawrence Lightfoot writes in a very particular way. There's some of you may well know it. I think it's like a sociological term for a particular kind of research, and it's called portraiture, where, just as you would imagine, what the researcher is doing is taking a very, very close look at what is going on in a situation and what they're seeing, in the same way that a portrait, that an artist who paints portraits, particularly those kind of miniatures, you know, those as opposed to huge canvases, but does that really fine detailed work. And so this is an idea that's been carried on into social services, and people have researched situations around about that. Now, I was absolutely fascinated by this idea that curiosity was an element of respect, because actually, I suppose in my, well, maybe not so much in my culture, but certainly in my household, curiosity was considered to be quite a rude thing. You didn't ask too many questions, right? You kept your nose out of other people's business. And certainly if you were a child, you didn't ask curious questions. And so for me, curiosity often seemed like an invasion. Something that I could be internally curious, but I certainly wouldn't be asking anyone about it. So it was absolutely the other end of the continuum from respect for me. Self-respect, that whole idea that if you can't respect yourself, if you don't respect yourself, it's difficult for you to offer respect to other people. And then this last idea, the idea of attention being an essential component of respect. And I kind of got hooked on these two notions of curiosity and attention. So while the book is beautifully written, it is such a treat to read. You know, it's absolutely worth you having a look at it. Engage them in order to serve them, you know, to be useful, to be helpful, to be interested, to be engaged in what's going on. That as soon as that happens, then much more is possible. There's a kind of container that's created that means that different kinds of things can happen. You know, the stuff that they used to talk about with the alchemists, who said that their search to turn lead into gold. And they said that what you needed to do was to find the right container. Yeah, it is a bit spooky, Kirk. Yeah, it's if you found the right container, then magic could happen. And I think that what O'Brien is saying and what Sarah Lawrence Lightfoot is saying is that actually the relationship is the container, right? The relationship is the thing that makes it possible for an exchange to be amplified, elevated, transformed into something that makes a huge difference in the life of a person, that is, you know, literally transformational for them. He talks about, Dave, could we get the slides again? Sorry. Right, okay. So there's the book, the gorgeous book, and alongside that, there's this brilliant article that John O'Brien has written. Sorry, that all sounds so rude when you say O'Brien has written it. But John O'Brien has written this article called Great Questions and the Art of Portraiture. And he references Sarah Lawrence Lightfoot in that, right? And he's saying this, I'll just read you the quote very quickly. He says, much more is possible when people consent to share part of their lives with someone who seeks to know them in order to serve both them and their community. And I think that when someone encounters somebody who has a genuine interest in them and their situation, is curious about their lives, wants to know more about what's going on, and wants to do that from the point of view of, well, I suppose initially, to be in a relationship with you, to form a relationship with you, to get to know you, to see what the two of you can do that's better than what you can do, one person can do on their own. I don't know, does that make sense? O'Brien saying, what we're really good at in services is we're great at taking dictation. You know, we repeat what people say to us, or we write down in detail what we see, or the questions that we're asking, you know, about people's health and their situation, their welfare, their physical condition or whatever. But he says that that's not what we're talking about here. That's not the stuff that makes a relationship. That he says it's much more as possible when people consent to share part of their lives with someone who seeks to know them in order to serve both them and their community. So there's an additional dimension to it. I don't know if you know the sort of ancient stories about the alchemists trying to turn lead into gold, right? So you probably came back at that point, where I was saying that they believed that the search was always to get the right container. And I think that the right container, and I think if you were in conversation, well, I don't know, if you're in conversation with John, you might agree that the container is the relationship, you know? The container is the interest, the container is the openness, it's the, you know, okay, documentation, that's really important, but what really matters is the way you interpret it, the way you analyze it, the story you tell about what you see, okay? And curiosity and attention are two ways of beginning to find out more about it and tell that story. Dave, could we move on to the next slide, please? Okay, Sarah Lawrence Lightfoot talks about authentic curiosity as the bedrock of respectful relationships. She says there has to be a desire to know about people. The questions that you ask have to be genuine. You're like, you do have to be interested in them. You can't, you know, when you're doing person-centered planning, or if you facilitate a person-centered planning training, and people say to you, could you give us a list of questions to ask? And I'm saying, can we not do that? Because actually, what you need to be doing is to be responding to the situation that the person's in and what you're hearing from them, rather than reading from a script. So they need to be genuinely curious questions. You know, tell me what's important about that for you. What would be great about that for you? You know? So there needs to be focused attention and probing interest. Now, what's that thing in... I've just had another thought there. We'll just cancel that. There needs to be focused attention and probing interest. Now, probing interest seems to me a wee bit like, it makes me a bit nervous in the way that curiosity did to start with, like you're sort of sticking your nose in people's lives. And it reminds me of the rules, you know, no digging, no fixing, you know, but there has to be a kind of, robust interest in someone's life. You ask the supplementary question. You know, what's important about that for you? Here it is. Oh yeah, and what would that mean for you in your life, you know? So it's not that you just take the answer at face value, you get to ask the supplementary question and you see where that goes. If the person's not interested in talking to you, then Yeah, that's fine. And I think there's got to be a difference between probing interest and interrogation. I have a friend who prides herself on her skill around appreciative inquiry. But actually what she does is she interrogates you. It's you're like, you get really sorry that you've introduced a new person or a new interester because there are 50 questions that come after it. And some of them just seem to me like inane. I think, why would you ask that question? Why would you ask me that question? Why do you need to know this? You know, so and I would say she interrogates people rather than asking a question that seems to take you on a bit of a journey. You know, Judith Snow's thing about a great question always has a quest in it. It always takes you on a journey somewhere. So, Dave, could we have the next slide, please? Okay, I wanted you to go back into your groups. And just for 5 minutes, I want you to think about what have you noticed in all that's been said so far. Does it make any difference to what you were thinking and noticing about the initial stories that people were telling you? You know, what's come up for you? And there's only 5 minutes to do this, but, you know, just a sort of quick round with each other. Have you noticed, what have you noticed in all that's been said so far? And does it make you think any differently from your initial noticing? You've noticed that Heather's been a bit careless about her papers being thrown everywhere. That's fair enough. But you might have noticed that there's that thing about curiosity. That, oh, I never thought about that. Or I could see how this, or no, I don't get any of that at all. But anyway, what have you noticed? 5 minutes, then come back. Welcome back. I think most people are back. Let's hope so. Dave, I wonder if I could ask you to share your screen. Thanks. So next slide, please, Dave, if you would. Okay, so I want to just say a wee bit about the art of portraiture and give you an example from Sarah Lawrence Lightfoot's book, just for you to hear. Portraiture is described as being a vivid and detailed description of someone or something. I think in the world of human services, I think we get the detailed description right. I just don't think it's very vivid. And that's been one of my concerns. You know, I was saying earlier on, I think that we talk about people in very functional ways. And we can describe all of that, but we can't really often describe how they look, how they move around the world, what their presence is like, what it's like to be in their company. And I wanted just to read you a wee bit from Sarah Lawrence Lightfoot, just to give you an idea of what I think a vivid description is. And in this, she's describing a man called Daywood Bay. Now, I had never heard of him before, so I hope that I'm getting his name right. He's an African-American and he's a photographer who's done a huge project in Harlem, okay? She says this about him. At 43, Daywood is a handsome, large man with an ample girth that he carries gracefully on his 5'10" frame. His erect posture and long gait make him seem much taller than he is. His light brown face is partially covered by a beard that he strokes when he is concentrating. His dark eyes, which dominate his face, are luminous and intense as they study a photograph or peer directly into the eyes of another person. When he is talking to people, he stands close, reading their eyes and their lips and maneuvering himself into a position to see their full faces. Even with a hearing aid lodged in his right ear, Daywood is still hard of hearing. When I read this description, and every person that she writes about in this book, she writes a similar kind of description as about an introduction to them. And I just felt this man jump off the page at me. You know, she talks about his long gait and his luminous eyes and, you know, and I was thinking if we were, you know, even just talking about some of our friends, you know, to what extent will we be able to give such a vivid description of them? so that they would do that for someone who didn't know them, they would come alive, you know, they would leap off the page. But I thought that what Sarah Lawrence Lightfoot did was exactly that, that she took me into Daywood Bay. You know, I just got an idea of what this man was like. She describes a Harvard professor, and you know, he walks around with his overcoat and his velvet lapels and his booming voice and his striking presence. And immediately I'm thinking, I've got a sense of who this person is. And I think that this idea about a vivid and detailed description really matters. I think it, for me anyway, what it does is it kind of lifts the person out of service land. It lifts them out of functional description. You know, it lifts them out of diagnosis and labeling and all that. And there's the creation of a real person standing in front of you, you know, a breathing, living, you know, vital individual. And more and more, I think, you know, it's how I want to see people. I want to write about people in a way that lifts them up. In order to do that, I have to use my words, okay? And I think I have to get more words than the words that I've been using up until now. And if my Californian friends will forgive me, because I've gone off on this before, right? I think using your words, finding great words to describe people, okay? But not using superlatives. You know, why just talk about someone being beautiful or something being beautiful when you could say that it was breathtaking or it was stunning or it was jaw-dropping? If you're trying to evoke an atmosphere, why would you just say, oh, it was awesome? Couldn't you say that it was sumptuous, that it was dappled, it was mist-shrouded? You know, we have these words. Beth Gallagher has just sent me a message saying, I can say awesome if I want to. Well, yeah, uh-huh. But, you know, you and I have talked about this before, Beth. So we either have functional words or we have these superlatives. And I think most of us kind of exist in a continuum of these words, you know, and I'm weary of superlatives, because I think that when you keep using them, then they become meaningless. Like, one day Beth Gallagher is going to meet something or somebody who is completely awesome and she'll know all about it. Then what word is she going to use to describe them? What you got in your arsenal, Beth, when you've used up awesome to describe something that was completely average? Yeah, she'll batter me for this afterwards, you know. So I think that in the process of finding and of painting vivid and detailed descriptions of people, I think find words, use them, you know, keep a notebook. You're all very funny and totally awesome too, right? But I know what I'm talking about. and I know it when I hear it. I just But I want to really encourage people when they're writing about people or trying to describe people, that we have that vivid description of them that raises them up, you know, that makes them three-dimensional and not just a, you know, kind of like a science experiment, really. So I think that's probably all I want to say about that. Dave, can we move on to the next slide? So you're going to go back into your groups, right? Here's the kicker. I would like you to take, well, there's two ways you can do this, right? One is that you could take one of the stories that you've heard about and think about think about writing at least an introductory paragraph of the story, bearing in mind what's been noticed and what's been talked about in the workshop. And I know that writing by committee is always difficult, so if you prefer, you could work on your own story. And we've got about 15 minutes for you to do this. Okay, I've said sort of 20 minutes there, but the panic earlier on about timings meant that we've just had to cut this down a wee bit. So 15 minutes available for you to either create a first paragraph of a story as a group or for you to individually work on your stories. And we'll ask if a few people were willing at the end to share what they've written, but there's no pressure on you to do that. Although individually, I would love you to share it with me. I would love you to email me it and tell me what you were thinking, or, you know, as you tell me what a load of old horse this has been, you know, I'd love to hear what you're thinking about your story. So into your groups, 15 minutes, either as a committee, write a story, think about what you've heard in the workshop, think about what you've heard about curiosity, think about what you've heard about how we can elevate people, think about how words can make a difference. Just think about what you've noticed and wondered about individual. Right? That would be great. Have a crack at it. We'll come back in 15 minutes and see how you go. Okay. Well, I hope that was more than fine for you. I hope that was good for you. Just a few comments before we kind of move on to hear some of the work that you've been doing. I just want to assure you that we'll make the information about the book and John's paper available to you, and the slides. Okay, so that will come to you. There'll be an evaluation form. What is it? Feedback form, and that will come as well. We really appreciate it if you would complete that and send it in. Given that this has been such a kind of experimental thing, really, it'd be great to get your feedback. And really honest feedback would be helpful. I mean, it might make me cry, but it would be helpful. We'll do that. We've just got some time to hear about some of your the stories that you've written. But bear in mind too that if you wanted to share some of your reflections from that last group, you can use the chat. You can write something up there. People will be able to see it, and we'll be gathering that up. So that would be very helpful too. So use the chat. But I'm interested. Some of you wrote collectively. Some of you wrote as individuals. And I just wondered if anyone who was interested in sharing a bit of what they've written, you know, just the first few sentences or whatever, what to raise a hand, I'll give you a call, we can unmute you. And Kirk Hinkleman, did you have your hand up? You did. Okay, let's hear then what you've got.
Okay. So it reads, it was an overcast morning, as is often the case in San Diego in the month of May. Cool, gray, a hint of moisture in the air. My favorite time of year, it's a weather condition that comes each year at the same time of the year, reminding me of the fortune of living on the coast of the Pacific Ocean, a connection to Mother Earth, an integral element of my spiritual person. The text came through, did you hear the running man is dead? This exchange went back and forth with, how do you know? And now that I think about it, I haven't seen him in a while. A neighbor had been out for a walk when near the bottom of our street, a steep half mile hill, she noticed something in her periphery, a small monument clearly written about the running man of Ariane Drive. But his family knew him as Steve.
It's beautiful. Thank you. Thank you, Steve. Just right in that misty morning. Thank you for that, Kirk. That's gorgeous. Anyone else want to share something? Yeah. Any other hands up? Who's that? That's Amy. Yeah, let's hear Amy. That'd be great. Thank you.
I just want to say we had a lot of fun.
Good.
Lots and lots of fun. And this was really, really cool. We came up with just three sentences. Really? But Gord is an old songsmith and animated connector who communicates with his whole body the songs within him. With his mischievous smile and sideways gaze, he sizes you up to see if you are worthy of his shanty. If the songs of your souls match, he will grab your arm and swing you into the rhythm of his song.
Beautiful. Beautiful. Swing you into the rhythm of his song. I really like that. What did you say? If the songs of your souls match?
If the songs of your souls match.
Gorgeous. It's gorgeous. It's the right, yeah. Thank you for that. Have we got time? I've kind of lost track of time. We've got time for one more?
I'll go. I can't raise my hand. It's Tanya. As Betty was wheeled out of the hospital in a dazed state, thinking of her friend who died suddenly from a freakish fall, familiar faces came forward. She knew the people who hugged her and told her everything would be okay. She felt some comfort by their presence and kind words, but through the haze, she understood that nothing would be the same. Joy was gone.
Very poignant, that joy was gone. What a line. Thank you, Tanya. Thank you. I'm just looking at my timekeeper here to see where we've finished. Okay, I would love to hear, this is a serious, request. I would love to hear what you've written or read what you've written. If you could bear to send it to Inclusion Press, Linda will give you some details when we write a sort of follow-up email to you. But if you could bear to share your work, I would absolutely love it. I so appreciate you coming here today. the Lunig reading was about really trying to inject a note of whimsy into what we're doing, because I think, you know, that's the place that we're in, this gorgeous kind of twilight world, you know, where it is possible for us to raise people up, to have people be seen as real people. So I really appreciate you coming along to try that out. You might want to, like I say, use the chat. It's just really helpful to hear what you or to read what you have to say. And we're just going to wind up now, really. And I wondered if you could, as you just quietly leave the group, and we say thanks for the time together, for the opportunity to share this. I hope it's been useful. I hope it's been fun. I hope Beth Gallagher's not too mad with me about, you know, slagging her about awesome, but, you know, I'll find out about that later. Thank you again for coming along and being part of the experiment, for just taking a chance on this. It's a great and glorious company to be in. So as you sign out, maybe as you leave, maybe you would just give us one word in the chat about what the workshop's been like for you. Go for it. And thank you so much. Bye-bye.
I think everyone should write awesome.
Yeah, go on, write awesome. That'd be great. That would really make me feel like someone had heard a single thing that I said. Thank you.
Yeah. It'd be perfect.
They made a
anything
whole
that I learned today. Yeah.
That's great.
Completely awesome.
Thank you.
Attitude. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Really appreciate it. I'm just going to read what you've all been saying now right here. Totally awesome, wicked awesome. Yeah, okay, just because you put another word in front of awesome doesn't make it right.
So, Heather, this is a cultural thing. It, depending on where you're from in the States, you say awesome differently.
Yeah
So okay. wicked awesome would be up in the Northeast.
Thank you so much. Go about your business and keep writing. Okay, brilliant. All these messages, this is so good. See ya.
Bye, thanks Heather.
No worries, see you soon, bye.
Bye Heather.
Bye.
Bye Heather.
See ya.
Awesome Beth, just awesome.
Awesome. Awesome class Heather.
Oh yeah, look at
super
that.
Awesome. It's like has tubular men. Man.
Totally
awesome. Oh, tubular, there you go.
Tubular.
Tubular. What's that?
It's been thank great.
You. Thank you, Hans. Thank you. Did you have a good birthday yesterday?
Yes, I loved it. Thank you.
That's good. Good. I'm glad. Hans, I thought it was so lovely that you were described as your wife's dear darling. I just that melted my heart.
I'll tell her.
Yeah, do. Smashly.
Good. Yeah. Bye-bye.
Bye.
See you, Hans.
See ya.